You're good on the screen.
All right. Good afternoon to the wonderful community of Montreal. We're continuing the Shabbaton. I'm just napkins because I'm starting to sweat. And this lecture, it's called Preparation for Eternal Life. Preparation for Eternal Life. Before I start the lecture, I brought you many CDs, audio, and DVDs right here. And there are many topics here that we didn't speak in this seminar, in this Shabbaton. So it's very recommended, especially the color DVD. All the color CDs are DVDs. And the blue ones are all audio. And they're all in English. There's one in Hebrew with English subtitle, and all the others is either in English or in Hebrew. Depend how it's written on it. If it's written in Hebrew, it's Hebrew. If it's in English, it's in English. My recommendation to each one of you to listen to these CDs. These CDs makes a lot of people religious and close to Hashem, because many people have doubts, and once you clarify their doubts, there's no more reason why not to fulfill their mission in life. The doubts create a short between God and the people. Once you remove the doubts, there is a wonderful connection. So, starting this lecture, the concept of this lecture is to prove that every time the Torah speaks about life, every time God mentioned life, thank you, every time God mentioned life in His Torah, when you ask every person in the world, what does it mean, life? How people define life? To breathe, to walk, to communicate, to eat, to sleep, to make money, to get married, to have children, to have fun. That's life. Thank you very much. You can leave the bottle here. It's going to be finished. Every time the Torah speaks about life, you ask the ordinary Jews and Goyim, it's needless to say, their idea would be the life that we are here, 60, 70, 80, 90 years, everyone with his life term. The answer is absolutely not. Absolutely not. For Hashem, for the creator of the world, since he is eternal, and the soul of the human being is eternal, because as I explained to you yesterday in the lecture, the soul of every individual is an integral part of God himself. When God blew the soul into Adam's body, it wasn't something that he was created separately. The Gemara say, which is the oral Torah, the Torah Shebe'al Peh, man de nafach mi de leke nafach. It's like taking a person taking a balloon and blow into the balloon, and the balloon starting to rise. What's inside? My breath. Something that came from me. Of course, it's very difficult to explain spiritual terms in physical terms, because it's completely two different words, but just for us to get the idea. Since God doesn't have breath, He doesn't have a body, He doesn't have a mouth, He doesn't have all these things that we understand, but He speaks to us in the language that we understand. That's why the Torah always say, the hand of Hashem, the nose of God. He doesn't have hand, He doesn't have nose. To think that God has an image of a person, it's kfirah. It's a main sin. It's a very serious sin. It's against the principle of Judaism to believe that God has an image. Because by imagining Him in a certain image, even as a light, even as imagining Him as a light, or like the sun, or like letters, or any kind of imagination, is against the regulation and against the obligations of the Torah. It's against the principle. Why? He is a spiritual energy. We don't have an understanding what it is. It's 100% spiritual. He's able to do whatever he wants. He's not limited. He's not subject to time. That's why his name appears in the Torah as four letters combination, Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey, which symbolize the three different times, the past, the present, and the future. From those four letters, you can write Haya, you can write Hoveh, you can write Yihyeh. Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey, gives you all three times. As a matter of fact, one of the most famous questions in history, and you hear about it almost in every lecture, and you hear about it in everywhere you go, is if God knows the future, how is it possible that we have a free choice? How is it possible? If the day that I was born, he already saw when I'll die and if I'll be righteous or wicked, technically, for our understanding is that we didn't know, we had no way to be otherwise. If he knew that I will die righteous, I couldn't be wicked. If he knew I'll die wicked, I couldn't be righteous. Because he already saw the end. Right? That's what everybody asks. So we start this lecture from this point, that everybody is confused from this question. How is it possible that I have a free choice? So first of all, we really don't have a free choice. We have a choice, not free choice. Many speakers today make that mistake by saying we have a free choice. It's not true. We don't have a free choice. I will explain to you now what is the difference between choice and free choice. A free choice is you come to find that you're looking for a job, and I have a business, and you came to a job interview, and this is what I tell you. If you're coming to work tomorrow at 9 o'clock in the morning and you work for me for 10 hours, I will pay you $10 an hour. For 10 hours, you make $100. If you come, you make $100. You don't come, no hard feelings. You can stay in bed, you can do whatever you want, it's your problem. I'm not forcing you to do anything. That's a free choice. When you are free to do whatever you wish, and nobody is persuading you in any way to each direction, that's called free choice. Nowhere in the Torah, you're going to find this option. Nowhere. Always the Torah gives us good and bad, and you have to choose between each one of them. You want to choose the right path, you're going to be rewarded. You want to choose the wrong path, nobody is holding your hand. Nobody is holding you. You do whatever you want. Nobody interferes with your free choice right now, as you're free to choose which way you want to go. But your choice is not really free. Why? Because if you choose the bad way, you understand that one day I will have to pay for what I did. Which means if God say you should not steal, and I'm a thief, and I'm stealing and making people miserable, there is no way to avoid the punishment. It's just a matter of time. Unless, if I will correct my evil way before the punishment will arrive. But nowhere in the Torah, God tells you, dear Jew, after you saw my brilliant, beautiful Torah, after you saw the miracles I made to you and your father throughout the generations, I will allow you to do whatever you wish. If you want to follow my Torah, I will reward you greatly. If you don't follow the Torah, no hard feeling. One day you die, you become sand, finished. If that's what the Torah would say, I wouldn't be here. And I'm sure the Rav also wouldn't come here and put all his efforts to arrange Shabbatonim and hopefully to help people to come closer to Hashem. What's the point? He won't get punished. There's no problem. One day he becomes sand. No. So he lost the reward. I feel bad for him. He chose to live in this life according to his wishes. At least he doesn't have to suffer for it. At least he doesn't have to pay for it. I don't have any obligation to go and save him. Saving him from what? From losing the reward? Is not as urgent as avoiding his payment later on. You understand so far the concept? There's nowhere in the Torah you can do whatever you want. It doesn't work that way. So what is it like? The same guy comes to apply for a job by me. And this is what I tell him. If you come tomorrow until 6 o'clock, you make $100. If you don't come, I send my bodyguard and he will collect from you $100. Whether you like it or not, he will get it out of you. Trust me. This is what I tell you. Now, you still have the choice not to come tomorrow. To lay in bed until somebody will wake you up at 11 or 12 or 4. You don't know when it will arrive. This is our life. That's exactly how it works. You can murder, and you can still walk around for 20 years. You can steal, and you build mansions. And you wonder, where is the justice? The Torah answers your question. The justice will arrive, sooner or later, for sure it will arrive. Now my question to you is, if the whole concept of our life is reward and punishment and choice, what to do, Why God doesn't do what he promised instantly, right away? Why he has so much patience? Why we see wicked people that making everyone miserable, celebrating for 40, 50 years and nothing happens to them supposedly? Where is the, and also we see the righteous people that suffer so much. Where is the justice? The answer is, if the justice will be instant, which means I just stole $100 from my friend's pocket. 5 seconds later, somebody stole $200 from me. Because the Torah says, if you're a thief, you're going to have to pay double. You stole $100, for sure you will have to pay $200 sooner or later. The question is, why not right away? I stole $100, I just turn around, $200 is gone from my pocket. Or somebody knocked me down and robbed me for $200. Or I just put $100 in a pushka box. 5 seconds later, I have $200 in my pocket. Or I just killed somebody. Boom, somebody shot me. A minute later, I just light a cigarette on Shabbat. Psh, explosion to pieces. And that's it. Everybody knows that you don't want to deal with, you don't want to play with God. It's no games. Shabbat is Shabbat. Why life is not like this? The answer is, if this is the way it would work, there was no point of creating this world. It defeats the purpose of this life. Why? If you get punished a second after you make the sin, you don't have any choice. You become a robot. You don't have any test. Even Arafat, Yimach Shimo, would keep Shabbat. Why? He just saw one Yosef turn a light a cigarette on and explode to death. And he saw another Yitzchak light a cigarette and he explode to death.
He made it.
So after that, what would happen? He said to his wife, Fatma, listen, Fatma, I just saw two people light a cigarette today. It's not a day to smoke. Everybody would stand like this. All the Jews on Shabbat, as soon as Shabbat starts, believe me, nobody would sing Lecha Dodi. All the Jews in the world would stand like this. Moshe, where are you? Shh. Shabbat. Didn't you see what happened? Let's not move. By mistake, I make a mistake. I don't want to move. That's no test. No test. If you give 100, you make 200 after a minute, the Nazis will donate all their money to the yeshivot. Why not? Who doesn't want to double his money every 2 minutes? What life is this? Where is the test that the Torah is speaking about? This is a test. A person that you give him poison and say, drink. And he said, no, I don't want to drink. He deserves a reward for not drinking? Sure, once he drinks, he dies. But if he drinks, and the chance that he will affect him as 1 to 1 million, and maybe it's going to happen in 7 years, oh, now there's a test. Maybe it won't happen. And that's what the whole life is all about. You can do whatever you want, supposedly, and you don't see an immediate result. Once in a while, Hashem is generous with us, and he shows us right away what's the result of what we did. We did something, and an hour later, we get the same thing. Once in a while, to show us, hey, don't forget, I'm watching you all the time. The fact that I did not react yet doesn't mean I'm not very upset at you and filling up your file with all the negative, derogatory things that you are doing. Every time the Torah speaks about life, nowhere he means life 70 years in this world. Why? Because a soul is eternal and a person lives forever. Right now he's in a body, in this body, I'm going to be in this body for X amount of years. I was in a different body before. When you say I, you don't mean me with my black or gray hair. You don't mean me. Maybe in my previous body I was blonde. Maybe in my other life I was bald. Maybe in my other life I was a woman. There's many possibilities who I was according to my test. And also you should understand one more thing before I'm going into the slide. This introduction is very important to understand what I'm going to speak about. You have to also understand one more thing. You are wondering, probably, why every person is a different person, has different personality, different character. I'll give you an example. You take 3 little children, 2 years old. You give each one of them a bag of pretzels. You just gave it to them. You come to the first one, give me one. No. Give me one. I just gave you the whole bag. Give me one. No. You take one. He's on the floor, rolling, screaming for 2 hours. I said, what's going on? I just gave him a whole bag. He doesn't want to give me one. Then you go to the second one, you tell him, give me one. He gives you one, but he's not so happy about it. He asks you, give me another one. Now it's already really. Then you give him you want to take the third one, he begins to cry. You come to the third one, say, give me one. He takes one or two to himself, he gives you the whole bag. Now, those three children, they still don't have any intelligence yet. They have a little bit. They don't know about the world. They don't know how difficult it is to make money. They do not know how much pretzels I have. Maybe I have a million bags in my closet. I can give them as much as they want. So what? Motivate them to be stingy. If maybe I can give you as much as you want, what's the problem to give me one from a thousand? This is how he died in his previous life. Now let's go to those three kids, A, B, and C. Go back 15 years before they were born in their previous life. This first one, A, that is very, very stingy, didn't even want to give one. He was an old person. He died 75 years old, was very wealthy. All his life, miserable people begged him for help, and he never gave $1 donation, not charity. He doesn't care about anybody, only about himself. Egoistic, stingy, and that's how he died. Maybe he was a Shomer Shabbos. Maybe he was a good husband, not cheating, you know, giving respect to his wife. Maybe even he was a good father. Maybe he was even knowing some Torah. It could be many possibilities. One thing for sure, he died stingy. And he is born again stingy from the same point where he stopped his previous test. Since he failed, he still has to correct that bad trait. And that's why Hashem kept that test still alive. My friend, you still did not correct that problem. However, maybe he already corrected his anger in his previous life. He worked on it not to be an angry person. So now he's born very nice, quiet. You try to drive him crazy, it doesn't work. It's very nice. The other one, you just tell him, hey, you made a mistake. Ah, he wants to kill you. Ah, I'm sorry, I just wanted to help you. He's ready to kill you. Some people, you say good morning to them, they already get angry. Yeah, as soon as their wife comes through the door, they already have a heart attack. Why? What did I do? They're angry like this about everybody. They died angry. They are born again angry. That's why sometimes you come to a person, you want help. He's very generous. He gives donation, it doesn't bother him. It doesn't burn his heart. Sometimes people give when they don't have a choice. They suffer for a month. They cannot sleep. I just gave $18 to the rabbi. What a fool I am. You know, for wow, you know what it is? How did I make such a mistake? Next time you warn me. They suffer. They died like this. This is how it works. So you see that the kids that still do not know what's good and bad, they have already a designed character. And each one is different than the other. Some love Torah. Some, the kids are not so attracted to Torah. One kid loves to daven in yeshiva. You see, the Rebbe is in love with him. Look at him. He's so spiritual. And the other one, all he cares is about Game Boys. He doesn't want to open the book. Before he even know what's going on. It's like this. Because that's how he died. So now when we look at ourselves, examine yourself. Who am I? Am I a generous or stingy? Whatever I am, that's what I was. I still have to correct it. Am I a lazy person or not? If I'm lazy, want to sleep all day, don't want to do anything, that's how I died. That's why I still have this problem. And that's how it works. So let's move on. No? Oh, okay. You can see everything I'm speaking about. I know it's in Hebrew, but I'm translating it, so don't worry about it. The Torah starts. The Torah starts, Shema Israel, listen Israel, to the laws and the sentences that I'm speaking to you today. You should learn them and keep them to do. La'asotam. Remember what I said yesterday? Not to be religious in your heart. Not that it's going to be on the shelf in your house. To say, Rabbi, I have the Torah on my shelf. It has to be in your knowledge. And it has to be materialized into action. La'asotam. Hashem made this covenant with us All of us alive, face to face, spoke to us from the fire. Right here, if the Torah wasn't given by Hashem to the Jews would refuse to accept it. Why? When you come to millions of people and you give them a book, and you claim that you are the messenger of God, first thing they're going to check in a book if there's any mistakes, no? They're going to find mistakes in a book. They know God never gave it to me. I'm a liar. I'm lying. I have my own motive. I want to be a leader. I want to get money. I want to be famous. Whatever the case may be. So once I'm opening a book that basically tells me you have to change from A to Z. You are a thief. You cannot steal. You cannot steal. You are a murderer. You should not kill. You are lazy. You cannot be lazy anymore. You have to put tefillin. You have to give a lot of what your income is. You have to give it out to people. There's a lot of things that a person is not interested to do. You have to divorce your wife because she's your father's sister. You didn't know until now that you're not allowed to marry her. Right now, you just found out you cannot touch your aunt. So, but I have 7 children. What am I going to do? What do you want from me? I only bought the Torah from Hashem. I didn't write it. So first of all, Moshe would prefer, believe me, to bring a very easy Torah to keep. That everybody will say, yes, sir, no problem, of course, what's the problem? Like Christianity. Hallelujah, ta-na-na-na, hallelujah, hallelujah, everything is allowed. Once in a while you give the father $50. Father, forgive me, finished. How much to do? You can eat whatever you want. You can be with almost everything you're allowed to do. Almost every, yeah, there are a few laws, I'm not saying no. But almost everything is allowed, so what's the problem? Of course. I can wear pants, I can do whatever I want. Technically, you should know the Goyim, they have only 7 laws to keep. 7 laws. They also are obligated to keep every law that is required by common sense, like respect your father and mother. They don't have a clear obligation in the Torah from God that they have to respect their parents. No, it's not a part of the 7 laws. But every fool knows you have to respect your father. The chimpanzees in a safari, they love their parents. When the chimpanzee, the gorilla, comes to sit on a chair, all the little kids run away. They're not sitting in their father's chair. They have rules. I'm sure you watch Discovery Channel once in your life, no? The animals have a lot of respect to their parents. The Italian mafia guy, when his father comes into the house, he's not rising? Sure he is. He's not going to sit in the head of the table. Vinny is not going to sit where Tony is sitting. It's not going to happen.
The Muslim also.
The Muslim. Anybody with common sense understand that. So laws that are required by common sense. Laws that are required.
You don't go to the elevator.
She said, what's your name?
Here went my recording to the garbage. All these efforts for the camera and it's gone. That's why the Torah says, Rabot machashavot belev ish. But okay, at least now I can say things that I'm afraid to say in front of the camera. Because it's anyways gone. Don't worry, Rabbi.
Just joking. So be free.
Be free.
I'm not taking cameras and no more CDs because I don't want to be locked.
All right.
I'm saying whatever I need.
Yeah. All right, so let's move on. So the Goyim, for instance, a single guy and a single girl, they can meet each other and move together and live like a husband and wife without marriage. They don't need to get married, they don't need to get divorced. They can move, it's not a sin for them. They live together as long as they declare that they are the couple, they have to be faithful one to another. They don't need any marriage ceremony. Why the Goyim get married? They learn from the Jews. Judaism started 2,000 years before Islam. So the Muslims saw that the Jews for 2,000 years, they have a ceremony with a ring. They learned from that. Same thing Christians. They saw the Jews are civilized. They are the children of God. He gave them Torah in front of millions of witnesses. If that's what God told them to do, I guess that's what we have to follow also. But technically, they don't have to. Nothing. They move in and they can live. And they can make sins together. They are allowed. The woman doesn't have to go to a mikveh. Because since she's not pure, she's never becoming impure. And even though she has her period, she doesn't have a problem. You can be with her. There's no problem. Many of the laws that applies to us, they don't have to. It's a lot easier to be a goy according to the Torah, for instance, than to be a Muslim. Muslim made a lot of phony laws that made their life a lot harder, and they're not getting any credit for it. Because it's all man-made law, like the Ramadan. They have to fast 40 days for nothing. It's like grinding water. God never told the Goyim to fast. So they made their life harder, when in reality Hashem allowed Fatma and Mustafa to be together after 2 minutes. They're allowed. They don't have to go to the Qadi for them to get married and all these things. They don't have to. But they made their life a lot harder. This is what happened when you don't have the truth. Your life is very confused. So the Torah say, you received the Torah, you all of you, heard me speaking to God. If one Jew didn't hear Moshe speaking to Hashem, he would say, excuse me, Moshe, we love you very much, you're a nice person, you did a lot for us. But what is this nonsense? You are coming to tell me what I heard? I know better than you what I heard. I'm here already for months, never heard a beep from God. What is this nonsense? Now remember, when Moshe came to them, how do we know that Moshe really spoke to God? How do we know? The Torah said that Moshe and Hashem spoke. But maybe, maybe Moshe came and he says, one second, shh, let me hear. Okay, Hashem. Okay, I got it. Hold on one second, let me say. Hashem just told me that we all have to keep Shabbat, we're not allowed to make fire on Shabbat. Hold on. Okay, what else? Something like this. Do you think the religion would start? If that's the way it was, I can do the same thing. I can get a group of people and say, hold on, I want to tell you what Hashem says. Hashem says, you have to give me 99% of your income every month. Okay? Hashem says, what is this? No, go and believe me now. Everybody can do it. Well, people are idiots if they're going to buy this nonsense. That's why the Torah says, Moshe yedaber, ve'elokim ya'anenu bekol. I always wonder to myself in the beginning, why it says Bekol? Of course Bekol! How do you answer a person? Then I realize, wait a minute. No, there's other ways to answer. He sees him in a vision, in a dream. People speak to the deceased people in a dream. Go and prove that it really happened. No, can you prove what you dreamt last night? That would create 50% doubt right there. That's why 80,000 religions and cults that started after Judaism are all nonsense. Why? For every intelligent human being, the first question has to be, how many witnesses saw that person receiving something from God? Name how many? None. Muslims admit, Muhammad came from the desert with the Quran, he bring Quran. How many people saw the angel Gabriel give you the Quran? Nobody. He himself say, nobody. 50-50 right there. If you're smart, you don't gamble on 50-50. It's gambling. How many people witnessed the dream of Mary? Can you witness a dream? Nobody. 50-50 right there. How many witnesses saw that millions of Jews heard Hashem? The entire nation of Israel. The only book that's speaking about the people that received the book is the Torah. No other religion refers to those who accept the Torah as a part of the book. No one. The people who receive Christianity, this was something that happened 200-300 years before. They have no idea what happened. Now they get a book. The book doesn't talk about them. They cannot testify that they saw that those things really happened. But the Jews received the Torah. They say the Torah is real. Why? Everything that the Torah says that happened to us, we saw. I saw blood. I see bread falling to me every day from heaven. Nobody can tell me that these miracles never happened because I witness it. That's why I'm willing to accept it. Even that it's not such an easy thing to do. It's a lot of laws. Even that 80% of the laws are against human logic and I don't understand anything. Chinese for me. I don't understand. Sacrifice, matzah, breadcrumbs. I don't understand. I don't understand the divine language. So why am I willing to change my whole life for something like this? Because I saw God speaking to Moshe. That's it. Let's move on. The Torah says, "Vaydaber Hashem elchem mitoch haesh." God spoke to you from the fire. Kol dvarim atem shomim. You hear voice, but you don't see any picture besides voice. Then the Torah continue. When you ask many Jews, who are the chosen people? You ask the goyim. Most of them also admit. Most of them, believe it or not. Who are the chosen people? The answer is the Jews. How did the Goyim know? They believe in the Torah. Christians, Muslims, they believe that the Torah was given to the Jews. They're not denying it. They just claim that God left the Jews and chose them after and gave them a book. But they never said the Torah wasn't given to the Jews. Of course. God chose the Jews. But the Jews made a scene of the golden calf and God left them. That's what they teach in a mosque. One, in Israel, there's one Arab that converted. Converted to Judaism. And he married a Baala Tshuva Bukharian Jew. They're happily married, as far as I know. And this ex-Muslim, I'm a curious person. I like to investigate cases. When I heard that, I was looking for him, and I heard one time he came to my friend's house. I went there after my lecture, and I met him. So I told him, tell me, what made you an Arab? It's very rare that Arabs are willing to risk their life to come to convert. In Israel, when so many Arabs on the street, they can stab you in a minute. It's a big risk. One minute you become a Jew. So he said, when I was a teenage, the teacher in a Muslim school, he said that God chose the Jews, and after the Jews made the sin of the golden calf, he annulled the covenant with them and left them alone, and that's it. Since then, they're not his children anymore. And we are now were given the chance. So he, as a clever Arab, he told the teacher, excuse me, sir, something is not making sense here. The sin of the golden calf started in the beginning of the 40 years that the Jews were in the desert. But we read in the entire Torah that God made them so many miracles. After that, he gave them so many orders. He protected them. He made them win wars. He let them enter the Holy Land. This is 40 years after the golden calf. You just said that he left the Jews after that sin. And this is what Islam is based on? So it has to be a mistake. It needless to say that his bones were broken after an hour and he could never come to school. So he had no choice. He had to go to the Jews to accept him. And Baruch Hashem, he became a rabbi today. He gives lectures about his way from Islam to... So as long as he's alive, let's enjoy from his experience and understand how they get these ideas over there. Okay, now let's move on. Many Jews think that the Jews are the chosen people. The answer is not true. Not true. Where does it say in the Torah that we are Am Sgula? That we are the chosen people? It never says that. This is what it really says. Pay attention. And now you tell me, each one of you, if you are considered Am Sgula or not. Tell me, listen good. The Torah says, you make God become your master. Become your God. You follow his ways. You keep his covenant and his mitzvot and you listen to him. And in return, as a result of what you did, after you made God your God and you listen to him and follow him and all that, he will make you a special nation. What does it mean, Am Sgula? It comes from the word Mesugal. Mesugal means able. Has abilities that other nations do not have to communicate directly to God. Jews have these abilities. Jews, because they are the children of the king, a son of the king, the prince can enter without appointment. He doesn't need to wait 2 years online. He breaks in and he comes in. Abba, Avinu Malkenu, I messed up. Come help me. Get me out of my problems. This is something the Jews have. Not that the Goyim cannot pray to Hashem. Don't get me wrong. They also can pray and Hashem listens to their prayers. But Jews, as the Torah describes, has a shortcut. Why? I'm making you Am Sgula, as I promise you, letitcha elyon al kol ha-goyim. I make you a nation above all the Gentiles. For my glory and my fame, to make you holy, because I'm holy and finished. That's it. So when is a Jew is Am Sgula? Not because his mother is Miriam or Rachel. A Jew with the earring and tattoos, smoking on Shabbat, it's not Am Sgula. What are you talking about? No Sgula, no difference between to any other Goy whatsoever, according to God's words. We have to be honest. We have to be objective. The Torah say, you want to be my son? You want to be special? You want to be holy? Not the way you live, my friend. No, no. You live like a Goy or you live like an animal, and you think just because your mother is Miriam and she was religious, you're also special? Baloney. You are nothing. You're just another Gentile. And I don't want to go too far and to be too extreme, but if you read the Shulchan Aruch, if you're brave, the Shulchan Aruch describes who is considered a Jew and who is not. And I promise you already, it doesn't go only by the mother. The mother is a strong requirement, but it's not enough to be a part of the nation of Hashem. Follow the laws. The laws in Ilchot Shabbat start from the first halakha, and you understand what I'm talking about. If you don't have patience for that, you're going to hear it in my CDs. But right now, let's move on. The Torah says, I know that you think that it's difficult to keep my laws, God says. But the truth is, no. It's a piece of cake. It's not really hard. Where does it say it? Let's read. כי המצווה הזאת אשר אנוכי מצווך היום, this mitzvot that I'm giving you today, לא נפלטי ממך ולא רחוקה היא. It's not so far. It's right next to you. לא בשמיים היא. It's not above heaven. To say who's going to go and bring it to us. It's so far. I have to climb all the way up to get it. No. This is an analogy. The Torah is speaking. It's not across the ocean to say who's going to get there and bring it to us. Ki karov elecha hadavar. It's right in your hand. Three words now. Pay very good attention. Three words. Ki karov elecha hadavar. Meod. It's very close to you. Beficha. In your mouth. One. Ubilvavcha. Two. Lasoto. Three. Beficha. Bilvavcha. Lasoto. Beficha, all the mitzvot in the Torah that relates to the mouth. Davening, praying, learning Torah, saying all kinds of brachot, birkat hamazon. This is all mitzvot that is going with the mouth. Sanctifying the name of Hashem. You know, all these things, it's mitzvot with the mouth. Beficha. Bilvavcha, it's all the mitzvot of faith, confidence in Hashem, integrity, being honest, being disciplined. It all comes from the heart, because that's where the evil inclination is. La'asoto, to do, is with the hands. All the mitzvot that you need hands for. Tefillin, lulav, etc., etc. Three categories. Some mitzvot applies to the mouth, some to the heart, some to the hands. Those three are a piece of cake in your hand. That means, if a Jew is religious or is not religious, and it's hard for him to keep the mitzvot, something is wrong in his system. We have to analyze where the problem is. Like when you go to the doctor, doctor, I have migraines. Let's check blood pressure. Let's check this. You have pain in the back. You're sure that you have, I don't know, like a slight disc. No, it could be kidneys. It can be gallbladder. It can be so many things. It can be stress. The brain is confused. Let's correct the problem. Let's see the root of the problem. It's hard for you to get up in the morning. Let's see what's the reason. It's hard for you to learn Torah. Let's check what's the problem. You're not faithful to your wife. Let's see where the problem comes from. The Torah is the answer to every problem in our life. Torah means in Hebrew instruction, or ra'ah. There's not one question in history that was asked that you don't find the answer in the Torah. Va'afoch ba, va'afoch ba, v'chul ba. Everything is there. But you need to be educated. The Torah say, you cannot be a businessman making millions all your life. You're in a business, you don't know aleph bet of the Torah, and you think you're going to be religious and righteous. You can dream, but it's not going to work. You can be the best lawyer in the world. You can be the best baker in the world, but you don't know aleph bet of the Torah. We don't have time to learn. Someone who is ignorant can never be righteous in the right level. Never. Why? I always said in my lectures that the biggest enemy of the Jew is not the goyim, not the Nazis, not the Arab, not even the money that destroys us so much and makes us addicted to materials, not even the women that makes us make sins, not the food that makes us addicted to it. This is all dangers, of course, problems. What's the biggest enemy of a Jew? Ignorance. Remember this. The same thing computer. I remember when I got my first laptop, I don't know, 7, 8 years ago, I was allergic to computer. Before I became a speaker, I was a businessman. I was also a banker. I didn't tell you yesterday, but I was very similar to what you did. But the difference between you and me is that you educated. You went to school, you got degrees. I was a fool that came from Israel and got lucky to push myself in with some you know, some of the things that I say, and accidentally I find myself as a representative to major bank from Chicago, and I was a businessman. But then when I became stronger and stronger in Emunah and Torah, I wanted to go learn full day Torah. I just couldn't stand the atmosphere in the office with the goyim around me, the things they were talking. So I was allergic to them, but I was also allergic to computers. Everyone in my office had computers on his desk. I'm the only one who works with papers and pencils. They all look at me and say, what is this? All these papers now, give me a break. Right. Get yourself a normal... I was allergic to... I'm afraid of computers. One day, I used to work with this. That's why I was very surprised when I saw this. I used to have this. I used to carry it to the lecture until 7, 8 years ago. So I have a friend, Isaac Ginsberger. We worked together in Kiro for many years, from Brooklyn. He told me, I don't understand you. You're a moron. You fool. What are you doing? Carrying all these boxes. Laptop, all the Torah in the laptop, 1, 2, 3. You have projector, small one. Why do you need all this? I said, no, it's not for me. Then he said, listen, you cannot come to the seminar and speak with this box. Forget about it. You have to bring it. You don't want to learn a laptop? I'm not taking you. So I had no choice. So he got me a laptop with 2 lectures in it already. So I started to, he told me, you don't have to know that much. All you have to know to press the arrow, up and down. That's it. I will be next to you, fine? That's it. You know, with the food comes the hunger. When you're not hungry, but the steak is served, all of a sudden you become hungry. So all of a sudden I decided that I need to have an email address. Why not? So I got an email address. Now listen to this. Listen, it's a true story. So I started to get emails. I used to give my business card, and all of a sudden people from last night's lecture asking me questions, and here, slowly it's growing, and I get it. Today I'm getting more than 100 emails a day. Minimum 100, sometimes even more. So the old days, 2, 3 a day, 4, 5, 7, it was already a busy day. So then my friend started to teach me about computers. He teach me every day. He comes, he teach me a little bit. One day he comes into my kitchen, he sees me sitting on the table, and I'm typing and pressing send. Then I begin to type again. I wrote it on a piece of paper, and I type, and I press send to another person. Then I start to type again, and I press send to another person. So this guy, Eyal, said, are you doing what I'm thinking you're doing? I said, what? This is how you send emails to all these people? Why are you going to be here for a week? So what can I do? Move you. Okay, where is your list? Check. 1, 2, 3, 4. You can send 100 emails in 1 second. What is this? Typing it 100 times. So then I realized, when you are an ignorant, it's painful. It's expensive. It costs a lot. To be an idiot in some industry, it costs a lot. Same thing an accountant. An accountant. I heard about an accountant that was lazy and he didn't learn the new IRS regulation, and he made a company lost $2 million on their tax return. Because one stupid mistake, he checked the wrong box in the tax return. $2 million the company lost. Ignorance is a killer. It's the biggest enemy. Now,
you have to think of outside the box or inside the box?
challenging here. Okay. So, the conclusion is, the less ignorant you are, the more chance to succeed you have. That's very simple. I didn't say anything out of the ordinary. But now is the point. What is the most important thing in the life of a person? What is the most important thing? Why my Creator created me for? What did He create me for? Forget about Torah now. Forget about Jews. Forget about this. A person in China, Mr. Ching Chang Lu, he wants to think about, what am I doing here? Mr. Ching Chang Mu, he knows somebody made me. Look, I'm intelligent. I have a very sophisticated system. Brain, 10 trillion connection, eyes, even though they narrow, but eyes, doesn't matter. I'm a very sophisticated person. So, who made me? Question number one, there is a Creator. I don't know him yet, because I never learned Torah, fine. But there is a Creator. Okay, now the Creator made me. I'm the most advanced machine in the creation. That means I'm the most important thing. Everything was created for me. But what for? Did you ever see a creation without a purpose? Show me one thing that was ever made by someone, and when you ask him, what did you make it for? He would say, I don't know. What is this? Computer had a purpose? This bottle of water has a purpose? Before they made that bottle of water, even though it's worth a penny, somebody designed it. A lot. They thought, how are we going to make the bottom? That it will be balanced and stabilized, that it won't fall, you know? So they made it a little bit like this. They made all these lines to make it more stable. They made it narrow here. Why? That the hands can hold it easily and it won't slide. They made the top very narrow, that it will not go out of the cup. You know how much thoughts in this lousy bottle that worth a penny? How much thoughts before they started to make it? To think that it was made by itself without a purpose, everybody knows it cannot be. So now a person say, okay, so my creator put me here. So now, if he wanted me to enjoy life, I already said that yesterday, I would be a chimpanzee. Chimpanzee also have a wife for free. He can do whatever he wants without a show. He doesn't have to buy a house 30 years mortgage, no doctors, no health insurance, no vaccine, no traffic every day, none of these things. Whatever we are dreaming to be, the dogs have for free. What most people like, sports, chimpanzee all day, sports, athletes, to swim, the fish swim faster than all of us together. Fish, yeah, you're throwing into the water. You say, so what's my dream, to win a gold medal, to be a great swimmer? What for? I would be a fish, a shark. To eat, I can be a dog. Did you see ever a dog, what great life they have? Every day I come, you know what, forget dog, the squirrels. You come in the morning to the garbage bags, all of them have holes, chicken bones on the driveway, pizza is open here. They made a whole meal, Zimun they made, the squirrels. And I pay the bill. At least it goes from my garbage. Now the squirrels and the dogs, they do not suffer when they eat my leftover. I, a homeless that take from the garbage, he suffers that he has to eat someone's germs. Because he understands. But the good dogs don't understand. They love it. Give me your leftover. The pigs eat our bathroom. Did you see pigs what they eat? You take the diapers of the baby, put by the pig, he eats it. 100%. By the way, you should know, every mitzvah has a lot of brilliance in it. We do not know 1% of 1% of 1% of the secrets of every mitzvah. But one thing I can tell you about why we're not allowed to eat pork. There's many reasons. One reason is because the pig eats everything. Everything. Bathroom, germs, viruses, whatever he sees. And the pig is different than all the other animals. Every animal digests their food in 4 hours. We digest our food in 6 hours, people. Animals digest their food in 4 hours. Pig, 24 hours. Now, when they slaughter the pig or shoot him, he has tons of food. You saw how heavy he is, no? Tons of bathroom, tons of dirt inside his stomach that slowly, slowly absorb into the veins, into the meat. And with all the liquid and the bathroom that he didn't go for the last few hours, they kill it. They don't put salt like the Jews to get rid of all the blood. So it absorbs, marinated in all the doo-doo of your son's diapers. You know? So everything goes into the meat with all the germs. And that's why, one, that's one of the reasons. That's, we don't know the real, real secrets of all the mitzvot of Hashem. But that's, here you go. Who did I learn it from? From a priest. Yeah. Yeah. A priest learned about the pig. And this is what he said to his people in his church. He say, brothers and sisters, you know they speak much nicer than us. Brothers and sisters. So, we have to learn one thing from the Jews. He says, if God told the Jews not to touch the pig, not to eat pork, there has to be a reason for it. It bothered me very much, so I wanted to know why. And I checked the difference between the pig and the animals, and this is what I found. The Jews are clever that they don't eat it. So let's not touch the pork anymore, he tells the Christians.
But the dog.
Anyway, so now, let's move on. I know Jeff is in a rush, so I got a rush. All right. I always hope that the lecture will be so good that the people that are in a rush forget that they're in a rush.
There is no rush today, that's it.
The rest is in a CD. But this lecture that I'm giving now, I only have in Hebrew. That's the problem. I never had the chance to make it in English because the Yetzer Hara always send me a kid or a baby that makes noise in the middle and the recording is finished. It's probably the 20th times that it happened today. I know, but I... You have to understand. You have to know when I'm serious, when I'm not. You know, you see, I follow instructions. Me, I'm not a funny person. I don't have this talent. I have a friend, Rav Yitzchak Fanger. We make a lot of seminars together. Fanger. As soon as he comes to the room, people begin to laugh. You have a Rav Lastri from Arachim. As soon as you see him, excuse my language, you make in your pants. Me, I'm a very serious person. I'm very deep. I like to check the small details to see it. I'm curious. But I'm not so natural. But my friend Ginsberger is giving me instructions behind the scenes. You have to be funny. You have to make jokes. You have to make jokes. People are not in a high level anymore like they used to. They're not so intelligent. They cannot only follow the information. You have to make them laugh. I see the Rav is very talented. I don't understand French, but I saw everyone is happy, laughing, enjoying. I have to work on it. So sometimes I make up some jokes.
Speaking French.
Anyway, let's move on. So the Torah says, I'm giving you the life and the good, the death and the bad, as I'm ordering you today to love your God, to follow His ways. The life and the death I put in front of you, the blessing and the curse, and you should choose the life. Again, I'm putting in front of you life and blessing, it's on one side, death and curse, and the other side. You choose where you want to go. You see, it's not a free choice. It's a threatening here. You go here, no problem, life and blessing. You go there, death and curse. But what does it mean life? What does it mean death? Now I want to explain what I started with. Please pay very good attention. What does it mean life? What does it mean death? Not what we think. Life and death, it's not what the chimpanzees and the monkeys and the dogs and the goyim has. No. No. It's life of eternity and eternal death. Eternal death. Now, I remember 10 years ago, there's one rabbi in Borough Park in Brooklyn. His name is Rabbi Lifshitz. Talmid Chacham, he writes book. He has very big Talmid Chacham. And he has an autistic kid, 12 years old at that time. Today he should be 22. 12 years old, autistic kids. There are about 11 autistic kids in the world that are reliable. Not everyone, what they say you have to listen to. 11 reliable, he's one of them. And the woman who communicate with them, Susie Zaminoff, her name, she's an American woman with special ed. She's an expert of communicating with autistics through computer. So she made a session with him. And few people from Muncie went, and I was lucky to go that day. So when I went there, as soon as I went here, now you have to understand, he doesn't know who I am. He doesn't know who I am. He doesn't know I give lectures. I was nothing. At that time, I didn't even have a website. But he doesn't know what I do. So when I went in, when I started to talk, everyone asked his question. When I started to speak to him, so he told me, first he told me, I want to speak to your wife. You have to bring your wife to me. So I told him, why? What happened? He said, your wife has a question that bothers her very much, and I'm the only one who can answer her the answer. So I want you, next time you come, you bring her. That's first question. I'm sure you're going to like to hear this answer, you as the wife. But wait a minute. I'll put you on hold. So now I said to him, okay, but I started to ask him questions. Then he told me something that until these days, when I remember, I get goosebumps. He told me, you and your wife were chosen by Hashem to save as many Jewish souls in Egypt. They call America Egypt. That's his words. In Egypt, before they will face eternal spiritual death. Mavet ruchani nitzchi. Eternal spiritual death. Before they will get that, you were chosen to save them. That's what he answered me. A week later, when I brought my wife, she went in. Now, you see, you don't identify yourself. That's the whole thing. So you see that it's real. She comes in. The house is very, very small. A very poor family. It's very, very tiny living room. two, four chairs already, that's the whole living room. So he sits in a chair, she walked in, as soon as she walked in, he knew her name, and he said, you come from a family, a descendant of a very big tzaddik. My wife is Ashkenazi American. Her last name used to be Tischler, but from one side is Segal, which is probably maybe the Nodab Yehuda, one of the important rabbanim. It's an honor for me that somebody from such an important descendant came to my home. That's how we started. I ask your husband to bring you here because I know there's a question who bothers you greatly. And I want you to get the answer today. No? And I don't know what question she has. He say, I know you're thinking that in Olam Haba, in the next world, your husband will get all the credit and you are just another housewife. That raising the children and cooking, but I want you to know that it doesn't work that way by Hashem. The wife receives everything that her husband is doing, 100% equal. And because of that, it started to give her a motivation speech. She came out like she was reborn, you know? So well, what did he say? I was outside. There's no room to sit in, it's a small room. She told me, that's the question. I said, yeah, that question, he never told me. Because the wife say, hey, you know, I mean, not every wife goes to give lectures, you know, to cook. So she said, what's the difference between me and Christine? She also raised children. She also cook. She also go to work. So what's the difference, really? Okay, I keep Shabbat. That's my own mitzvot. But in Zikui Arabim, she's 100%. So this is just to give you an idea how it works. Now, spiritual, eternal death. Now I'm going to prove it now to you in front of you. That what he said, it's exactly written in the Torah. Oh, let's move on. The life and the death, it's right here in the bottom. The life and the death are in front of you. The blessing and the curse, and you should choose the life. Lema'an tichye ata vezarecha. You should choose the life that you and your children after you would live. Not living now, will live. When are you going to be alive? After you will choose the right path. The path of the life and the blessing. Which means, what's the other options? If you go to the other path of the death and the curse, you are right now dead already. Before you even enter, it's all about the choice. I want to be tzaddik. I make the first step into the right path. I begin to be alive. I want to be Rasha, I'm dead all the time. A person can live 70 years here and not even 1 hour of his life net, he was alive. Nothing. Take away all the sleeping, take away sitting in the traffic doing nothing, take away bathroom, take away showers, take away eating, take away the amount of time that he works in there. And how many hours a day is alive? No Torah, no mitzvot, no nothing. Like the chilonim, the secular. Finally, when they have some time, what do? Golf. Rabbi, where are you? Come this weekend to the seminar. No, Rabbi, I'm going to play golf. Me and my friend, they carry all this thing. Okay, so what is your life? What's the purpose of your life? To hit the ball? What is it? To drive a nice car? There's some minorities in New York, without mentioning their names, their life is their car. They work a lot, and they finally buy like a BMW, and from this moment on, they worship the car. Every day, they put oil on the wheels, they clean the. And you wonder to yourself, what is the purpose of the life of these people? What are they living for? Now, it gets even better. It gets even better. Listen good. Shh. I'm torturing you. Yes. I'm torturing you. I'm strict with you, God says. To test you. What's the purpose of the tortures? What does it mean, torture? No business. Unemployed. God forbid cancer. Migraines. Cannot find a wife already. I'm 40. How many years I'm going to look? I'm dying already. Children are not so good. A boy is sick. Chas v'shalom, there's so many tragedies. So many tragedies in the world. How to believe what's going on. I'm torturing you. I'm strict with you. What for? Because I'm sadistic? I enjoy to sit up there and see you crying? Of course not. God forbid to think even. Why am I strict with you? Why it's going very hard? Why? To test you. To see, to know what's in your heart. Are you going to keep my mitzvot or not? So the next time somebody asks you, what's the purpose of the creation? One of them, it's to keep the mitzvot. To know them and not to do them, that's not the purpose. To keep. But it gets even better. The Torah says to know. Only after you will pass those tortures, based on your reaction, I will know if you're grateful to me or ungrateful to me. I will know if you're religious, you follow my ways, or you are an atheist or a wicked or whatever you want to call it. I always wondered, HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Avraham Avinu 10 different tests. 10 hard tests, check one by one, very hard tests. None of us would pass those tests, none of us. Finally, the last test was that he told him, take Yitzchak and slaughter him. After 99 years, he waited for a son that inherit all his billions that he had. After he gave seminars to all the goyim, to all the Gentiles, that you're not allowed to kill your babies, because the goyim used to sacrifice their babies to the fire, in front of those idols. That was a common thing. They worship idols, they worship the sun, the moon. This is what many cults. This is way before Christianity and Islam. This is way before Buddhism or Hinduism. This is way before the Torah was given even. So Hashem told Avraham, tell all these goyim that I'm not interested in their babies or all these things. It's a big mistake what they do. So Avraham is giving them lectures about you should not kill your sons. And one day Hashem come and say, the son that I promise you that is going to inherit you, I want you to kill him. Kill him. Kill him for me. Complete opposite of what he told him all these years. And Avraham doesn't make a beep. First thing, Avraham is going to sleep as usual. Do you know a person that knows tomorrow has to kill his only son and he goes to snore? Avraham, where are you? Sarah is asking. I'm resting. Snoring. Enjoying the night. You kill your only son tomorrow. How can you sleep? I have a flight. I cannot sleep from the pressure not to miss it. Right? So Avraham, how do I know he went to sleep? Vayashkem Avraham baboker. He got up early in the morning. Second thing, he could have kept the whole day to take Avraham to Har HaMoriah in Jerusalem at 7 in the evening. Half an hour before it gets dark. That's still the day. Why go 5 in the morning to do it? I'm rushing to do what you told me. That's how much I love your mitzvot and your commandments. No question asked. But why am I telling you all of a sudden this story? Supposedly there's no connection to the topic. There is. Because now Hashem comes to Avraham and told him something that should shock our hearts. Ata yadati ki yere Elokim ata. Now I'm putting my stamp on you. That you are fearful for me and you yere shamayim, you are a tzaddik. What does it mean, ata yadati? After 9 times that the goyim puts him in a fire, after all the things that happened to him, he didn't know Hashem yet that Avraham is righteous? The answer is not yet. Not yet. When officially Hashem declared that Avraham is a tzaddik, after the 10 tests. After the 10 tests. What are we learning from here? That each one of us is judged based on his potential. Not based on what you do, only. Based on how much you could have done. When a person dies, I saw in some of the books of the Kabbalist, that's speaking about the trial. We have 1 year trial after we die. That's why we say Kaddish on the deceased people for 1 year. 1 year trial. It's not a joke. Every sin of our life is going to be reviewed from all angles. The good that we did and the bad. And then we will get a sentence. Let's hope it's going to be a positive one. Cannot run away from reality. Ein ro'a ve'ozen shomat ve'chol ma'asecha ba'sefer nichtavim. There's an eye who watch over you. There's an ear who listens to you. And everything you do has been registered in the book of God. What for? As a memory? For the trial. Mishpat Rechaim Yud Bet Chodesh. Let's hope that we, Bezrat Hashem, will come with some positive things to present over there. But this is what's going on here. The Torah says Moshe Rabbeinu is the most righteous person ever lived. The most humble one. And Hashem called him Avdi Moshe, my servant Moshe. And he calls the Torah, Torat Moshe Avdi. The Torah of Moshe. He didn't call it the Torah of Yosef Mizrahi. He didn't call it the Torah of whatever. He called it the Torah of Moshe, one person in history. All of a sudden, we review in the oral Torah that Moshe and his brother Aaron, everybody understand that Aaron was also righteous, no question. They are equal. They are equal. Moshe and Aaron shkulim hem, the Torah says. They are equal in their level in Shamayim. Moshe is, let's say, 99% righteous, because he made some mistakes, and no one is perfect. And Aaron is 99% perfect. Why the entire Torah say Moshe, 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 all of a sudden, the Torah say, why sometimes Hashem say Moshe and Aaron, and sometimes Aaron and Moshe? Why? To teach you that they are both equal. But it's a contradiction, supposedly. The answer is, pay attention good. The answer is, yes, Moshe is more righteous. Yes, Moshe has more merits, more zchuyot. After all, he's the messenger of God, the main one. Yes, no question. Yes, Moshe was even more humble. That's what the Torah says. But Moshe fulfilled X amount of his potential, and Aaron fulfilled the same exact potential of his potential. Which means, if you take two Jews, Avram and Yitzchak, Avram is very, very fanatic. Yeshivot, Torah, modesty, everything. Yitzchak, religious, gives tzedakah, he comes to shul, he learns, not like him. Look, comparing them, there's nothing to compare. Because we don't see everything. Hashem knows exactly that Avram fulfilled 90% of his potential. And this Yitzchak that looks a little bit more modern, fulfilled 95% of his potential. So who is greater? The more modern one that looks a little bit less. But we do not know our potential. We have to do our best. We cannot sit and say, oh, I'm already doing enough for my potential. How do you know? You gotta aim for the best, because you don't know how much. Each one of us could be Moshe Rabbeinu. We don't know. That's why I saw in the Kabbalist books that it says like this. The worst disappointment and pain that the people have when their trial begin is when they show them who you were supposed to be. Before we analyze your sins, before you get to that part, Hashem takes you, Reuven, Shimon, Yitzchak, Sarah, Miriam, whatever you are, with your mini skirt in a disco and all this show, and show you, you were supposed to be the Rebbitzin that speaks in a stadium to 10,000 people. And they all comes closer to Hashem. You'll be in the highest place in heaven. In a very, very good VIP league. And look at you where you are. Worse than a Goya. Seeing what I was supposed to be and what I became, it's the biggest killer. Chazal says the shame is the biggest punishment that the soul can take. The biggest. What is it like? One person wants to make a scene with a lady. He wants to make a scene. He takes this Christine and he wants to make a scene. His Yetzer Hara is too much for him. And he wants to make a scene. So he's hiding. He goes to some hotel. And he comes to the hotel to make a scene. As he enters the hotel, he sees one goy or goya cleaning the room. Vacuum and everything. So amiga, she tells him, oh, como esta, senor? So, right, when this amiga saw him with his yarmulke or whatever, walked into the room, his conscience are killing him. Wow, what a bushot, an embarrassment. So because of the embarrassment, what does he do? Hey, amiga, did you find maybe my key? I was here yesterday, I lost my key. He changed the subject. So, where is my key? Well, he's embarrassed. Well, she's going to know that as soon as she comes to the room, I'm going to make a scene, me, a Jew, like this. So the shame kills him. So he said to Christine, let's go, we'll come next week. Next week he comes, he goes into the room. He sees a little 3-year-old kid sitting there with a lollipop. Hi. Hey, darling, go to your mommy. He doesn't want to go, the kid. You know this kid? Ah, the scream. Go, go. No, no, leave me alone. He said to her, I cannot make the scene in front of this kid. What? Okay, let's go, we come next week. Next week he comes back. See, there's a black, ugly dog like this with two shining eyes. The dog looks at him. He comes, he tries to push the dog out of the room. Arr! The dog gets angry. He's starting to go crazy. Go now, finally, I can't. Go! The dog doesn't want to move. That's the story. It's called, that's the mashal. What's the nimshal? After 120 years, we come in front of Hashem. And Hashem will show us that scenario that we went to the hotel to make the scene, and Amiga was there, and the little boy was there, and the dog was there, everything.
On plasma.
Everything will be in high definition, high definition quality. And Hashem will tell us, tell me, am I worse than a dog for you? So you say, God forbid, God, you a dog for me? Chas v'shalom, I wasn't religious, but I never thought you a dog. So Hashem will show you, the dog was staring at you when you went to make a scene. You were embarrassed to make the scene in front of this lousy dog. But if the dog wasn't there, you would make the scene. What about me that I'm watching you when you make the scene? 70 years I'm feeding you, I'm giving you oxygen, I do so much for you. And this is the thank you you're giving me? After the Torah warned you so many times not to touch a goy or a goya, because I chose you from all the nations to be mine, this is how you stab me? This is how you're torturing me? You torturing me! I'm your father! Where are we going to hide? One time I saw a guy in the yeshiva, very dressed up. I said to him, what's going on today? What, it's a party today? In the middle of the day. So he said, no, I'm going on a date. I'm going on a shidduch. So I told him, where are you going? He said, to Brooklyn. From Muncie to Brooklyn, it's like from Montreal to here. It's far. Need to take a bus, $15 each direction. And the yeshiva guy, don't have money, doesn't have money. So I told him, no, and where are you going to take her? He said, I'm going to that restaurant and this. I said, you have money? So he said, yes. So you have enough? He said, yeah, I have $100. So, oh, $100, you're rich. So he said, the Rav gave me the $100 to go on a date. I said, ah, this is how it works here. You go to the Rav, you tell him I have to go to the date, he gives you the money. So he said, yeah, how else I can go? I'm learning Torah all day. I'm here already for a few years. How else am I going to go to the Shidduch? So I said, wow, very interesting. So then I asked him, I said, tell me, I want to ask you a question. When you ask the Rav to give you the $100, even though it's the regular procedure here, everyone does it, what did you feel when he handed you the $100? He said, I wanted to die. I couldn't pick up my head. Like you know, those beggars who come in the door, excuse me, tzedaka, they always hide their face with a hat or something. They don't come. You ever saw a person knock on your door? Tzedaka. No, tzedaka. There is some. Then the world is over. The world is over.
The bank.
Okay, anyway, so I told him, what did you feel? He said, I wanted to die. So I told him, what if I would bring a machine to the yeshiva? The machine has two arms. You put your head inside, you press a button, the two arms are holding your jaws like this. That's it, you cannot pull your head. It's stuck now. You press another button, there's a boxing glove. It gives you a punch to your forehead. Boom, you get out, you fall on the floor, and $100 is falling like this. And you pick it up for the punch you got. Next shidduch that you have, you would go to the Rav, or you would go to the machine?
He is going to be married.
he said, of course to the machine. But I'd rather get that punch Then go to the Rav and ask for the money. The embarrassment is a killer. The machine, there's no embarrassment. I'm not embarrassed from the machine. You know, did you ever see a boxing match? Yeah. What happened when Anthony knocked down Muhammad? Now Muhammad is on the floor. He sees stars. And this Anthony is going like this, you know, and everybody clap. 10,000 people. What's the first thing Muhammad would do after he was knocked out? Always. check if I'm wrong or not. Better you don't check, but in case you watch a boxing match, remember me. First thing he does after the referee count, 1, 2, 9, 10, and he takes the hand of Anthony like this. Muhammad is holding the ropes of the ring and climbing like this on his hands. And always, always, he goes like this. Like this. Why the losers always have the urge to get back on their feet and wave to the crowd to say, I'm still standing. I wasn't defeated completely. To avoid 1 minute of busha, of embarrassment. All the physical pain he has, and 5 hours you hear he died in hospital. That's what happened usually. I one time drove in Manhattan in Broadway. If you know, Broadway is a diagonal street. I get to the light, night time. I see a stretch white limo next to me. All the way in the back, somebody's sitting and the window is open. Then my friend tells me, you recognize this guy in the limo? I say, no. He said, this is the legendary boxer, Muhammad Ali. That's why I say Muhammad fell. They have all kinds of names. He say, yeah, this is the boxer, Muhammad Ali. So my friend screamed to him, Muhammad, Muhammad. So he looks. He cannot stare where the voice comes. And we are 3 feet away from him. We stand by the light. So he goes like this. He went like this with the window. He's still in his head. His head is so messed up from all the punches he got. He thinks that he's already programmed. I have to avoid the shame. I have to go like this. So the Torah says like this. I'm testing you to see what's in your heart. Are you going to keep my mitzvot or not? We almost done. Give me 10 more minutes and we're done. 10, melamed, not 20. So the Torah says, I'm reading to you, it's all on the screen. You should know today, the same way a father is strict with the son, this is how your God is strict with you. You have to keep his mitzvot, to follow his way and fear him. Many people come and say, Rabbi, you're too strict. Just talk about the beauty of the Torah. Don't talk about punishment. Don't talk about fear. We don't like this. Just say, the Torah is beautiful. You're going to enjoy Shabbat. You sing, you dance. You know, hallelujah. We also have hallelujah in Tzuked Zimra in the morning. Especially when you wait an hour for Minyan. The hallelujah becomes a whole ceremony. So anyway, so the point is, saying such a thing is really saying, erase half of the Torah. That's what he's saying. When Hashem gave the Torah, he said to you and your children, Ad Olam, for everyone, I want everyone to love me and to fear me at the same time. To love only, it's baloney. To fear only, it's also baloney. It will never work. Nobody worship the Torah of Hashem and follow it based on love only. No. The mind of a person is, if I will speed on this highway, they'll take away my license and it's going to cost me $1,000. That's why it slows down. Take away the police, show me one guy will drive 55 miles an hour. Take away the police. They say, 1 week no police in the highways. Some will. Find me those some. I'm still looking for them. Even now when they're hiding every corner, everybody's zooming. Why? The mind of a person is, I have something to lose. If I have nothing to lose, I don't have the push, the urge. So the Torah says like this. The Torah says like this. I know you're afraid of your parnasa. You think, now I'm going to become religious. First thing I will do, I will close my business on Shabbat. My business does the best business on Shabbat. Rabbi, it's weekend. All week I make $5,000. Shabbat alone I make $4,000. You tell me to close Shabbat, I'll be bankrupt. That's what you hear. Or, all my business is based on cheating and lying to my customer and stealing their money. Now you're telling me to be religious, what am I going to eat? You know, I tell them this camera, it's brand new, not refurbished. But it's refurbished. I make an extra $100 with this lie. I have a bagel store. They come, excuse me, this tuna salad is from today? Of course, you're insulting me, madam. But it's from 3 weeks ago. It's mixed with what the rat did on it, you know, all the mice over there. Yeah. They always mix it to look it fresh. He doesn't want to throw at $15 tuna to the garbage, so he keeps mixing it. If he's not honest, if he's afraid of Hashem, after a day or two or three, whatever it takes, he gets rid of it, or he gives it to the poor people before it becomes spoiled. Yes, there are honest people. But this guy wants to become religious. All his life is based on lies and being a crook. And the Torah say, you're lying, you're stealing, you're going to pay double sooner or later. Just have patience, it's going to come. So here is the secret of the Parnassah. Inside the Torah said, I'm giving you cities full of wealth that you did not build. Houses full of greatness that you did not fulfill. Wells they are digged already, you did not dig them. Vineyards, olives, you did not plant. You should eat, enjoy, and be full. No problem. It's not a crime to be full, to enjoy food, no problem. To enjoy your car, your nice house, your Persian rugs, enjoy. No problem. It's not a crime. Don't be addicted to it. That's a crime. To be addicted to jewelry and this and that, it's a crime. To enjoy from it a little bit to a certain extent, it's no problem. Judaism is not to torture yourself like Christians trying to do. No. It's against the Torah. A person is not allowed to torture himself. Some Jews throughout history, they started to copy certain things that the Christians doing. No, that's not the way. The Torah did not tell a person you came here to torture yourself. No. But the Torah say, don't be addicted to all these things around you. Be careful. So the Torah say, enjoy. But be careful. Don't forget to thank me. V'achalta v'savata uverachta et Hashem elekecha. Yishamer lecha, be very careful that you won't dare to say, Kochi ve'otzem yadi asali et ha'chayil hazeh. Be very careful not to think, and definitely not to say, thanks to my talent, thanks to my brilliance, thanks to my all kinds of skills, I became a millionaire or I'm so successful. No. Everything you have, I gave you. Whether you understand, whether you don't, everything you have, I gave you. If I don't want you to have it in 1 second, I take it away from you. I send you Madoff. Madoff will take care of you. After 4 years that you save a dollar by dollar, $100 million comes Madoff, takes away everything, and that's it. Do not test your God as your fathers did in the desert. You're not allowed to say, Rabbi, I will be religious. You know when? When I'll get married. When God gives me a good wife, then I'll be religious. When I'm going to be successful buying this company, I, as results, will be grateful to God and I will start keeping Shabbat. It doesn't work that way. If that's your plan, you will never get what you want, most likely. No one is allowed to make tests. If Hashem will do this and this and this, then I will listen to him. It doesn't work that way. You are obligated to follow the truth, whether you like it, not, you know, whatever the case is. First, this is the truth. It comes before your convenience. Na'aseh v'nishma. V'asita yashar, v'atov b'enei Hashem leman yetav lach. Do not be religious according to your understanding. It's not acceptable. Do not be good according to your understanding. What does it mean? I'm religious in my way, Rabbi. I'm religious in my way. I think this is too much. I think this is primitive. I think that's not what the Torah really meant. I don't think God is strict, that he's going to punish me. I don't believe it. What do you mean? You're ignoring the Torah? The Torah told you everything was going to be. I'm religious in my way. It doesn't work. The Torah says, "V'asita yashar," you have to do what's straight and decent in the eyes of your God, not in your eyes. If every person would give a speech about what he thinks is correct to do, then why Adolf Hitler is wicked? Why? That's his opinion, that you have to exterminate all the Jews from the world. That's his decent and good, according to his opinion. Come Mustafa, he has also his own good. Come Yitzchak, he has his opinion. Come the American guys that like baseball, for him that's the life. Everyone has a different truth. Everyone has a different good. Who cares? Who cares what your opinions are? Are you allowed to decide how what is the right way? No, your creator already told you what's the right way. Rabbi, this is my understanding. Once in a while I gotta take my wife to this dirty movie. That's my understanding, but the Torah says you're not allowed to step there. Rabbi, I have a Christian friend, he invited me to his wedding. What can I do that I'm gonna have to be in a filthy church over there and repeat all the nonsense that they say about J.C. Penney? What am I gonna have to, what do you want from me? You know? What do you mean? The Torah says you're not allowed to step there. Once you step there, it contaminates your entire soul. You cannot see the truth of Judaism anymore. You know how many Jews are captured into those cults and Christianity with their filth, and they cannot come out of there? Don't think that it's only by them. There are some Jewish cults also, without saying name, I don't want to be controversial, but there are some cults among Judaism that are nothing better than them. They also have a wrong way. They modify the Torah according to their understanding. We have to follow the roles of our fathers and grandfather, Shulchan Aruch, the Gemara, the Rishonim, the Poskim, all the way until Moshe Rabbeinu. We have one way, one truth. Time is running out. You should know today, you're asking probably, how come all these wicked people are millionaires? The judge in a court, he makes so many sins, he receives bribes, he sends innocent people to jail, he does all kinds of things. He makes ruling clearly against the Torah. The Torah says you're not allowed to be gays. He makes a rule, you have to let them, you have to give them rights. If you go against them, we're going to put you in jail. Every decision that he makes every day in a secular court goes against the Torah. And he's a millionaire. He has a chauffeur. Look at him, he's on television. Look at this soccer player that plays on Shabbat. Everybody come with their cigarettes and car to watch him on Shabbat. He makes millions. Look at what's going on here. Look at Bin Laden, a murderer. He murdered 3,000 people in one shot. And he has supposedly $20 billion. So where is the justice, right? Here is what the Torah says. Now listen, I'm telling you, mate, that's probably the most important thing of this entire day so far. If you want to see where it is, Parashat Va'etchanan, the last three verses. Don't say I didn't tell you. You should know that your God is a faithful God. Not a crook, not a politician, not a liar. He's a faithful God. He is going to keep the covenant that he made with you, for sure. Shomera Brit. Ve'achesed, and the kindness, le'ohavav, to his lovers who keeps his mitzvot. Who is considered a lover of God? I'm sure all of you want to be in this category, I have no doubt. But many of you are not in this category. The truth must be said loud. I myself don't think I'm in this category. With no, you know, discrimination here. My opinion that I still have a long way to get there. But each one according to his understanding where you rate yourself. The more you learn, you know that you have to do a lot more. But Ezrat Hashem, one day I'll get there. But in general, who is a lover of Hashem? Someone who keeps all his mitzvot. I am going to benefit you for 1,000 generations. How? I only live one generation. Here, le'elef dor, 1,000 generations, you're going to be rewarded. And another place in the Torah it says, I'm testing you, I'm strict with you, to see, do you love me or not? Before I read to you, if you're going to keep my mitzvot or not. That's in one place in the Torah. In another place, I'm checking you to see if you love me. If you follow my ways, what for? To reward you in your end. Lehativcha ba'acharitecha. Who understands Hebrew here? Okay, what's the word acharit means? End. Sof, acharit hayamim, end of days. Acharit, sof. Mazel lehativ comes from the word tov. To benefit you. To reward you. In the end, where in the end, when you close your eyes and the soul comes out of the body, the reward will begin. Or chas v'shalom, the opposite, depend who you are. So don't ask, where is the justice? I'm doing everything and I still didn't make $1 million yet. Don't ask this nonsense. Speaking like this, that means you don't have even 1% understanding how the creation works. And here is the answer why it's not like this. I'm paying my haters. I'm paying my haters, those who hate me. Cash to their face to get rid of them. I will not delay their payment. What payment? The haters of Hashem, what payment they deserve? Every secular Jew once in a while put tefillin, at least once in his bar mitzvah, that's already a great reward. Once in a while he made kiddush, let's say, with the family, he was invited, he heard kiddush, he said amen. One time he was invited, he ate matzah in Pesach. Here and there he put $2, $5 in a tzedakah box. Over the years, he has a few thousand mitzvot, over the years, all together, 5 years, 2 there, 1 there, it accumulates. He reached age 40, 50, he has no intention to make repentance, to be a tzaddik. Continue to live like a goy. He's now going to marry another Christina. It's his third marriage already. He had Christine, Christina, and Christiana. So now, yeah, you know how many Jews I know like this, unfortunately? So now, this guy has no plans to change his way. No plans. So Hashem say, okay, how much I owe you? Since you don't believe in the afterlife, since you ignore my Torah, since you don't care about what I say, I owe you for those mitzvot. I must pay you in this life because I don't want you with me there. So I begin to pay you. Take another Mercedes. Take another vacation home. Take another antique. Take another Chagall picture, $1 million in your living room. What? You want to buy a baseball team? Yeah. Okay. All right. And in the end, he pays you for everything you ever did. Then you come in front of him and say, Hashem, after all, well, I kept one Shabbat in my life. Why you didn't pay me? I gave you a beautiful wife for that. All right, that was for that? Okay. What about my bar mitzvah I put tefillin? Okay, here, for that you got that business. Okay. What about this? Forgot you had 3 children. What, you take it for granted? 15% of the Jews are barren. I gave you 3 children. Each one of them is billions of dollars. You would buy, if you have $10 billion and you don't have children, you would pay 9.5 to buy children. One boy. Right? You will pay 9.5 to buy. So I gave you 3. You take it for granted? Everything you have, he will show you one by one what did you get each thing for what. And now you're naked, you're empty. The idea is not to be in this category. We want to be mostly mitzvot. We're going to have some sins. It's impossible not to have sins. But we want to pay for our sins here. That when we go there, we'll be clean. Where does it say it in the Torah? I will not delay the payment to my haters. I will pay them immediately in this life. From here, what do we learn? That someone who loves Hashem and keeps the mitzvot, he delay the payment for him, as he said clearly in other places in the Torah. But from here, you see that if God loves you, he doesn't give you the reward in this lousy life, 60, 70 years. It's a blink of the eye. Chazal say, "Ha'olam hazeh ke'eref ayin," a blink of the eye. Before you realize it's over. Look at the 70, 75 years people. Tell them, I want you to write on a piece of paper your entire life. From the day you remember yourself until this moment. How many pages you think they can write? How many? 3, 4 pages? 10 pages? How many pages they will conclude their life? 70 years.
Infinity.
5, 6 pages, they conclude their entire life. Life is a blink of the eye. One Jew, Lo Aleinu, he was 70 years old and he got cancer. He's dying in a hospital, and one Chinese doctor one day sneak into his room with a glass. He said, "Mr. Moskowitz, I have good news for you." "Yeah, what's the good news?" His eyes opened up. He said, "You see, I just smuggled it from China. Nobody knows about it. It's not approved or anything by the FDA yet, but when you drink this glass, tomorrow you get out of the hospital completely healthy, no cancer in your body. It will destroy all the cancer cells in your body in 24 hours. The Jew came back to life. "Ah, really? Thank you. You're so nice." "Wait a minute. Not that fast." He pulls up a bunch of papers. His lawyers jump out of the closet. "Sir, Mr. Moskowitz, we checked your financial record. We saw that you're worth $100 million. You have account here in Switzerland, in Israel, this, in Montreal, in New York. Baruch Hashem, you have plenty of accounts. I know some of them you forgot about already, but we already did it for you. You have $100 million. So we will be very nice to you. We will give you this medicine only for 99 million. We would leave you a million. What do you want? You're 70 years old. You have $1 million. You survive. Sign here, sign here, sign here. Once you sign, we'll make a wire. Then we'll give you, and the doctor, the Chinese doctor, is smiling. I want you to know, Mr. Moskowitz, it cost me less than $1 to make this medicine, but nobody knows the secret. Now, what do you think? Mr. Moskowitz or anybody else would buy the medicine or not? Or he would rather die?
Yes.
He would buy it. Nobody wants to die. Nobody wants to die. Even if you think that you are a wise guy or a wise girl, when Chas v'Shalom, if you ever get to this situation, you will give everything not to die. I saw one of the biggest tzaddikim that we had in our generation that was dying from cancer in a hospital in New York. Very famous speaker. Many people became religious from his CDs. I don't want to say names, but very famous person. I went to visit him in a hospital. He had cancer in his stomach, and he was dying already. His beard was falling off, his hair. So every person who came to his room, trust me when I tell you, a driver, a young Jew, an old Jew, rabbi, anybody, no exception. Come, 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 give me a blessing. So I asked him, everybody who comes, you ask for a blessing? He said, yeah, how do I know who he is? Maybe he's very important in Shamayim, he's tzaddik, he's going to give me a blessing. Thanks to him, I'll get cured. Ask this guy. He was so afraid to die. And believe me, we wish to have 1% of his merits to this person. He was shaking. He was begging not to die. Like going crazy. What's going to be with this, with my kids, with my wife, with my yeshiva? Non-stop, he's mumbling. I saw in my eyes, this is a person with strong emunah. As much as you think you are big shot, when Chas v'Shalom this time comes, you give everything. So Mr. Moskowitz, of course, signs everything. He gave him the medicine. He drank. 2 hours later, he was already running, jogging. So now, Mr. Moskowitz doesn't know if he's going to live a week, a month, a year. Nobody gives him any guarantees. Still 70 years old. Tomorrow he can die from something else. Cancer is not the only killer. Now I want to ask you, this is the mashal. What's the nimshal? Most of us here in this seminar are very young. I saw a lot of people in their 20s. That's really the beginning of our life. We have right now supposedly 40, 50, 60 years ahead of us. Each day in reality worth billions for us. If we had the money and we had to buy an extra day of life, we would pay. Why don't we take advantage on it? Why are we grinding water? Why we waste our entire life? It's like a battery that dies every second. Why don't we say, wait a minute, Hashem puts me here, I have something to achieve. How much more time I'm going to lose? Before it's going to be too late for me. And remember, it's no free choice, it's a choice. In the end, we have to pay. You got a credit card, you go shopping, you enjoy for a month, the bill will come another week. Now the interest begins. A lot of people get their first credit card. The next thing is see them with a nice car, nice suit. How are you doing, Moshe? Ah, you became rich? Yeah. $40,000 on a credit card. 15 years to pay the interest. If it's in Israel, forget it. They come take your laundry machine after a week if you don't pay the bill. Here, you still have some rights. So that's it. Now you ask me, still, how do we know? Shh. How do we know that to be alive, the only way to be alive is to follow Hashem's ways and to listen to His mitzvot? How do we know? I'm going to read it to you and you tell me if I'm right or wrong. Here. Word by word. Shh. And that will be the last thing for tonight, for today. Shh. I'm going to read. If you doubt what I say, it's right in front of you. Anefesh achotet itamut. The soul that committing sins will pay the reward. Hitamut means for eternity. Soon you're going to see. Hit will be cut out of the eternal life for the sins that he committed. Son is not responsible for the sins of his father. A father is not responsible for the sins of his son. That means if it's not his fault. For instance, if the father put his boy in a very bad public school and he became Mr. Williams, instead of being Mr. Yitzchak, he became Mr. Williams. He liked rap music, tattoos, smoking drugs, going robbing banks. What made him like this? The school. His father, the stingy father that didn't want to pay $500 every month, even though he was driving a Rolls Royce. He didn't want. Yeshiva costs too much money, Rabbi. You want my son? Take him for free. You know, in Israel, in Petah Tikva, there is a place, there's a shul, and an old man, 83 years old, is getting an aliyah la Torah from the rabbi. 83 years old, the old man comes up to the Torah. As soon as he says, Baruch Hu et Hashem, he starts to cry. He didn't even finish the sentence. An old man cry like this. Everybody got nervous in the shul. You okay, sir? What happened? He cries. They bring him napkins. After a few minutes, he said, Rabbi asked him, why are you crying? He said, 70 years ago, exactly, I had a bar mitzvah in Europe. My father took me to the rabbi for the first and last time in my life I put tefillin. And that's the first time in my life I got an aliyah to the Torah. And since then until today, I never saw the Torah. 7 years, I never saw the Torah once. This is the second time and perhaps the last time in my life that I'm seeing the Torah and I have the chance to say bracha on the Torah. And the curse of the rabbi to my father happened exactly as he said. Exactly as the rabbi said. So the rabbi in Israel, in Petah Tikva, it's the city of Petah Tikva, he asked him, God forbid, what rabbi cursed your father? He say, his name was, he doesn't know anything, but his name was Rav Chaim Oizer. It's the chief rabbi of Ashkenaz. Of all the European Jews, he was the chief rabbi. Shh. So you say, what is Chas v'Shalom? Why the rabbi cursed your father? He say, he not really cursed him, but this is what he told him. When I came up to the shul, he never saw me. I wasn't in his school. So he asked my father, where is your son learning? So my father say, in a goy school, public school, with all the goyim. So my father told the rabbi told my father, how dare you sending him there? You're destroying his soul forever. Bring him to the yeshiva. He said, no, it's not for me. You're asking too much money. I don't want to bring him there. So my father told him, if you're going to do what you want to do and send him tomorrow back to this public school, now aren't you afraid that the next time your son will ever see the Torah will be in 70 years from now? That's what he told my father. And I was a kid listening to this conversation. And today, I'm exactly 70 years after my bar mitzvah. I'm 83 years old today. And you called me and you gave me an aliyah. So he continued to cry. So now the rabbi started to cry. True story that happened. This is a few years ago in Israel. He started to cry. So now everybody asked the rabbi, Rabbi, what happened now? It's a drama here. So you don't get it, huh? What's the name of this shul? Everybody open up their eyes. Bet HaKnesset, Rabbi Chaim Ozer, in Rav Chaim Ozer Street, in Petah Tikva. In Israel, 70 years after. The rabbi in Europe told him, you send your son to public school, the next time you see the Torah will be in 70 years. It happened exactly. And in what street? And in what shul? Name after that Rav. Coincidence? Ah, Jeff, what do you think? Can happen by a chance?
Yes.
No.
So,
like Shabbat Shalom.
So, Aben Tzidkat HaTzadik Alav, a righteous person is responsible for his righteousness. It's your credit. Verishat HaRasha Alav Tiyeh. And if you're wicked, it's 100% your fault. Aval, this is the good news. No, 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 no. This is the good news. Shh. If the wicked Jew, which means he doesn't listen to Hashem, will make tshuva, will make repentance, and slowly, slowly come back to the right way, everything he said will be forgotten. Everything he did, all the bad he did will be erased. This is an opportunity to erase everything, but we don't know when we die. Maybe tomorrow, how do we know? Right now, before tomorrow, it's maybe too late. And if the righteous person will go to the wicked side, everything he did for good will also be erased. Because it goes how you're going to end your life, with how many credits you have. If you show that you don't care about the religion, you dumped it, and you went to the evil way, you lost everything. And the last sentence, I marked it with a line, that's the subject of this lecture. That's what we started, and that's what we finish with. Hashem said, God says, this is the highest level of promise. I swear on my name, God says, that I'm not interested to kill the dead. I am interested that he will return from his bad way, that he should live. Again, first question, how can you kill the dead? He's already dead. If somebody is dead here, you kick him, he doesn't feel anything. How can you kill the dead? And this is the divine language. No errors here. You cannot kill the dead in our world, what we think is dead. The God doesn't speak about dead body. You cannot kill the dead. We're talking dead soul. Dead soul. The soul is disconnected from me. It's dead spiritually. Who cares about the body? A bunch of molecules. It's the soul. It's dead. I'm not interested to execute this dead person. He's already disconnected. I am interested that he will make repentance, return back to the right way, that he should live. What do you mean he should live? He's alive now. He just ate steak in the dining room. What do you mean? Last night he was dancing all night. He's alive. No, he's not. He drives on Shabbat, he's not alive. He steals, he's not alive. He doesn't learn Torah, he's not alive. He's not a decent person, he has a problem. Etc., etc. So what is the conclusion of this lecture? What's the conclusion before we just say the last word for, I guess, we have more lectures? We have another one? Okay, for this lecture, the last word, and then I give you time for questions. The next time when you hear that the Torah is speaking about you should live, that you and your children should live, the Torah doesn't talk about life here. Don't be a fool and think that Hashem gives us 20, 30 years to eat here like monkeys and dogs, and that's the reward of the spiritual God. No. It's eternity. That's why when people died, you shouldn't cry too much about them. No. You have to cry about them if they were wicked. Now you have to cry. You cry for them because they're going to suffer for it. But if a righteous person dies, no, you cry 1 week, 1 month, finish. You don't kill yourself over it. Don't worry, he's in a good place. You do Kaddish for him, you do Mishnayot, you give Tzedakah, you give CDs to Jews to become more religious for his Neshama, and that's it. Because anyway, we join him soon. It's like your son went to Yeshiva, you sit and cry. You know he's in Israel, in a very good place. You don't sit and cry. You miss him very much, but you know he's in a good place. However, if Chas v'Shalom, he wasn't a kosher Jew, there's no ending to how much we have to cry for him. That's the truth. But instead of sitting and crying for them, we might as do something for them. We can still help our relatives that pass away with certain things. If you want to know, I'll tell you after the lecture. I have a whole lecture about it in my website. It's called Kaddish. And many other ways to help the deceased people. But again, thank you very much for being so patient. I know it went a little bit longer, but I learned from the Rav. Yesterday went long. I allowed myself also to steal almost an hour. But again, thank you very much. And hopefully we'll meet again today, no? Soon.